Former Philippine Senator Antonio Trillanes believes Vice President Sara Duterte is bound for impeachment. Trillanes denied Duterte's claims he and other opposition lawmakers are being controlled by what she calls a political handler. He also believes Duterte is trying to convince the public officials are conspiring to impeach her. But the former senator says it's only a matter of time before Duterte is removed from office, as lawmakers are currently investigating her alleged misuse of public funds.
Vice President Sara Duterte is just bluffing. She's used to doing or saying these things, but she doesn't have anything. Okay, I dare her to show anything that she has, but believe me, within the next week or two, she won't be able to show anything. It's just like the Polvoron videos that they've been teasing the whole country, and in the end, they just came up with an AI video.
The Marcos administration's multi-party alliance finally revealing its senatorial lineup for the 2025 midterm polls. Interior Chief Benher Abalos was the first candidate to be announced by President Marcos. Five incumbent senators are also seeking re-election under the Bagong Pilipinas Alliance banner. These include Senators Bong Revilla, Francis Tolentino Litulapid, Pia Cayetano, and the President's sister Aimee Marcos. Three former senators, including former Senate President Tito Soto, will also be attempting to return to the upper chamber. Completing the administration slate, Makati Mayor Abby Binay, House Lawmaker Camille Villar, and ACT CIS Party List Representative Erwin Tulio. The accomplishments and experiences will greatly contribute to the country.
Napagsuwang magigiting na Pilipino na may taglay na sipag at galing para maging pinuno. Tangan ang prinsipyong makatao, makadiyos, makabansa. Titindig para sa interes ng bayan at sa kapakanan at karapatan ng bawat isang Pilipino. Sa aking pag-endorso, ang tanging hiling ko ay mapanatili ang kanilang katapatan at pagmamahal sa bansa. Ito ang pinakamahalagang katangian ng kandidato na aking tinitignan at pinag-iisipan. Sila ay ating magiging katuwang sa ating pagsulong at sa patuloy na pag-unlad ng ating bansa. Atin po sila ay samahan at suportahan.
Marcos started forming the Alianza para sa Bagong Pilipinas last May as a continuation of his unity campaign. The alliance is composed of five major political parties, including the President's Partido Federal ng Pilipinas, and Martin Romualdez led Lakas CMD.
Ang sabi nila, ang halalan daw ay panahon ng pagkakabitak-bitak, pagsisiraan, pagkakahati-hati. Subalit, kabaliktaran po ang inululunsad ng ating alyansa. Sapagkat ito ay isang kilusang bayan na magbubuklod sa pinakamalawak na puwersa ng mga nagmamahal sa inang bayan, na ikakampanya ang isang programang pangkaunlaran.
Unity is crucial. Each of our parties, whether it be Partido Federal ng Pilipinas, Lakas CND, the National People's Coalition, and the National Lista Party, or the National Unity Party, represents different perspectives, histories, and stories. But today, we come together not as separate groups, but as one force for the people. We stand united because we know that in unity, we find the power to turn our dreams into reality.
Philippine lawmaker Johnny Pimentel standing by the credibility of former Education Undersecretary Gloria Mercado amid her allegations and revelations against Vice President Sara Duterte. Mercado earlier revealed she received 50,000 pesos from Duterte every month on top of her salary, which she believes was intended to influence her decisions as head of the DepEd's procurement group. The Vice President denied the allegations, challenging Mercado to present documents to prove her claim. Pimentel adds more individuals are willing to step forward to shed light on the matter.
Bukas nga, meron na naman kaming bagong resource person, dalawa. So, actually, marami ho ang nagbo-volunteer. Pero yung iba, nasa active service pa. They do not want to come out. Pero nagkakatugma-tugma naman yung mga sinasabi nila sa amin. And these two persons, nag-under oath na.
Philippine central bankers could cut key rate by 25 basis points at their October 17 meeting and by another 25 basis points at their December 19 meeting. This was revealed by BSP Governor Eli Remolona himself on the sidelines of an Asian Development Bank forum Wednesday. Remolona points to easing inflation for the forecast. Philippine consumer prices slowed to a 7-month low in August. And during the same month, the Monetary Board reduced the BSP's benchmark rate by 25 basis points to 6.25%. That's the first rate cut in nearly 4 years.
President Marcos now speaking at the signing of a law against agriculture economic sabotage. Let's listen.
Security as well. It jeopardizes the livelihood of hardworking Filipino farmers and fisherfolk, and it threatens the food sustainability of our communities. In 2023 alone, we lost over 3 billion pesos to agricultural smuggling, a staggering amount. And in less than 9 months this year, we have seized over 230 million peso worth of smuggled agricultural products. Every sack of smuggled rice, every under-the-table onion deal, every substandard meat sneaking past our quarantine checks, these are not just numbers. They represent lives, families, and futures that are being compromised. So let us not ignore the cartels, the organized crime syndicates that manipulate prices and control supplies. They have names, they have networks, and they are operating right under our noses. But today marks a turning point. The passage of the Anti-Agricultural Economic Sabotage Act will set in motion transformative outcomes. It is a proactive measure to prevent the entry of smuggled agricultural products, ensuring that the correct duties and taxes are paid while imposing higher penalties on violators. This law shapes a stronger, more resilient agricultural sector that defends both our farmers and our consumers. It also safeguards the public health by preventing the consumption or industrial processing of agricultural products that lack the necessary sanitary and phytosanitary permits. It ensures that what ends up on the tables of every Filipino family are safe and of the highest quality. Under this law, smuggling, hoarding, profiteering, and cartel operations involving agricultural and fishery products will now be classified as economic sabotage, a non-bailable offense punishable by life imprisonment and fines up to 5 times the value of the goods involved. And let me be clear. This law does not just target the masterminds. It holds all accomplices accountable, financiers, brokers, employees, even transporters. We are establishing the Anti-Agricultural Economic Sabotage Council, which I will chair, alongside the Secretaries of Agriculture, Finance, Transportation, Trade and Industry, and Interior and Local Government, and Justice, and other key officials. We will enforce the law and ensure that swift and decisive action is taken against anyone who dares to sabotage our agricultural sector. Together with that, we are also creating an anti-agricultural economic sabotage enforcement group dedicated to dismantling smuggling operation and apprehending offenders. This law provides for the development of a special team of prosecutors nationwide to expedite cases related to agricultural sabotage. No longer will these cases gather dust. They will be prioritized and they will be resolved urgently. We will confront and dismantle the powerful forces that have long exploited our system for their own gain.
ensuring that justice prevails and the dignity of our agricultural sector is upheld. No more backdoors, no more shortcuts, and certainly no more turning a blind eye in Bagong Pilipinas. By eliminating smuggling, hoarding, profiteering, and other cartel activities, we are not only shielding our local producers, but also providing consumers with affordable agricultural and fishery products. This law is not just another policy. It is your battle cry. I urge each of you to be vigilant, to report wrongdoing, and to hold accountable those who seek to undermine our nation. The food security of our country, the stability of prices, and the dignity of our farmers depends on us all. This law is clearly a clarion call to restore trust in our institutions and reinvigorate faith in our justice system. As we pave the path with integrity and dedication, let us envision a Philippines where our farmers flourish, our markets are filled with produce locally sourced. No parent has to worry about feeding their children because of spiraling food prices. Let us stand resolute in this commitment, for together we shall cultivate not only the land, but the future of our beloved nation. Maraming salamat sa inyong lahat. Mabuhay ang bagong Pilipinas. Magandang hapon po sa inyong lahat.
Thank you, Mr. President. At this juncture, may we request the President.
All right, Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos, there in the signing of the Anti-Agricultural Economic Sabotage Law, which he says hits Filipinos significantly at the core, and he hopes now it's passing, it will fight smuggling, it will fight economic sabotage head on. Now that body is going to be chaired by the President himself, as he reiterates vigilance versus cartels and those involved in price manipulation, particularly in food prices and agricultural products. The President foresees the passing of the Anti-Agricultural Economic Sabotage Law as one that possesses stiffer penalties against violators, both from the smugglers themselves and those along the entire supply chain. Now, he also mentioned that the law safeguards public health and it is non-bailable. So those offenders will be punished at the full extent of the law. It is punishable with life imprisonment. Now, the enforcement group creation is also to follow this signing of the act, and that group is going to handle and expedite cases against agricultural economic smuggling. Now, for perspective, the government has fought about 200 million worth of smuggling activities, smuggled products, in just the past year. U.S. banking king Jaime Diamond talks about global trade and investments with Philippine business leaders in Manila. The J.P. Morgan Chase chairman and CEO held a roundtable Wednesday with some of the most important names in the local business space. They include Mr. Jaime Augusto Sobelde Ayala, Sabina Boitis, Kevin Tan, and Jollibee Group's Tony Tan Kaktiong. Diamond is also said to have engaged in discussions on technology and cybersecurity. JP Morgan says it remains bullish on its prospects in the Philippines, where 20,000 employees support its global operations. Diamond's visit came amid increased cooperation between Manila and Washington in several fronts, from the economy to defense.
Corporate stories this Thursday. Double Dragon's Hotel 101 Global begins issuing so-called golden visas to the first batch of its unit owners in Madrid. The joint venture of Edgar Garcia II and Jollibee Group's Tony Tan Kaktiong called it a milestone that was completed half a year since owners purchased their units in Hotel 101 Madrid. The Spain investor visa is a residence permit for non-European citizens with significant investments in Spain, real estate assets worth 500,000 euros included. The hotel chain looks to fully sell out 680 units in its Madrid branch before completion by the end of 2025, just in time for the Formula One Grand Prix race in Spain. Next to the Ayala Group, it approves the selling of treasury shares worth 2.2 billion pesos. Those amount to over 3 million common shares at 720 pesos apiece. Proceeds from the sale will be used for general corporate purposes. And finally, to Alternergy, it secured director's approval to divest shares in special purpose vehicle firms. It's doing away with its stake in three companies in favor of its own, Alternergy Solar Holdings Corp. The group now intends to make ASHCO its intermediate holding firm for its solar project companies.
Israel preparing for possible ground operations into Lebanon. Israel's military chief says the airstrikes are continuing in order to destroy Hezbollah infrastructure and clear the way for a possible ground incursion. Lebanon's health minister says at least 51 were killed and 223 wounded as Israel widened its airstrikes Wednesday. He also estimates the number of displaced in the hundreds of thousands. Israel, meanwhile, reports shooting down a missile near Tel Aviv. Hezbollah claims to have targeted Israel's spy agency with a ballistic missile in a further escalation of the nearly year-long conflict. Despite growing tensions in Lebanon, this Filipino worker says towering bills are forcing her to stay and simply hope for the best.
I was really thinking, my boss already told me if you want to go, you can go anytime. They are trying to enforce me to go home, but I choose to stay because, you know, going back home in the Philippines is kind of, it's a matter of thinking for the future. And, you know, 30,000 pesos is not easy to find in the Philippines. And right now, okay, the government are offering money, but that's not enough, especially I have some responsibilities.
The United States, France, and several allies called for an immediate 21-day ceasefire across the Israel-Lebanon border, while also expressing support for a ceasefire in Gaza following intense discussions at the United Nations on Wednesday. The International Monetary Fund seeks greater efforts to ensure economic stability amid global headwinds. This appeal made by IMF Chief Kristalina Georgieva in the lender's annual report. She called for multilateral cooperation to prevent further geopolitical shocks as well as fiscal adjustments and to continue bringing down inflation. All these, as Georgieva described, as turbulent the global economy after the pandemic as a result of wars and tighter monetary policies. The IMF chief also says nations must work to tackle trends that affect the world, from climate change, digitalization and artificial intelligence. The Bulgarian economist who secured a second term as leader of the IMF vowed they will be responsive to the member countries' needs while looking well into the future.